Hello, everybody! Yay! Yay! Welcome to the monthly Drupal NYC Meetup. My name is Alex Ross. I will be your host for this evening. This is our second meetup here in our new space here at 30 Rocks. That's pretty cool. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I understand we had some door issues trying to get in here, so for those of you who had trouble, I apologize, but clearly you made it in, so that worked out okay. But I was told to tell people in the future, and we'll clarify this, that there are two doors that say observation deck at the top, and not just one. They're right next to each other. So for the future, it's the one that is closer to 6th Avenue. Tell your friends. Huh? I don't know whether it has the marquee or the neon, but it's the one closer to 6th Avenue. So tell your friends, tell your neighbors, and tell your neighbor's friends. Yeah? If you go in the other one, they will have no idea who you are, what you're doing there, and they're kind of strict about security around here, so they may just toss you out. Yeah, we actually, so the question was, why can't we put like a big, like, you know, easel with a sign on it or something? Technically, NBC and Comcast do not own this building. This building is owned by Tishman Spire. And they don't like putting signs up in the lobby type area. We actually asked that question and we were told a profound no. So there you go. But in the other entrance, we do have the pages down there waiting for you. So if you ever walk into this meetup and you don't see the pages down there waiting for you, you probably went in the wrong entrance or you're there on the wrong day. Yeah, a little bit like a Drupal speakeasy. Yeah, all right. okay, so I kind of already went through the housekeeping, but just in case, this is all the housekeeping. Mute your devices. Down at the bottom of the presentation is info about our wireless network. It's also info about how to get the Drupal NYC organizers on Twitter and on Meetup.com and all that good stuff. So if you're interested, pay attention down there at the bottom. Okay, let's talk about the agenda. I'm just going to do this on the screen. So the doors have opened. We had some pizza, which was sponsored by NBC's talent acquisition folks. So thank you again to them. They've agreed to feed us because they know that the fastest way to a developer's heart is pizza. So thank you for that. We'll do a couple of quick announcements in a minute. I'll talk about introductions when we get to introductions. Then we have several talks today. We have two lightning talks, and we have one more substantial talk, which I'm looking forward to. It'll be interesting. And then afterwards, when we're all done, we are going to have some quick closing remarks, and then we typically go downstairs to Bill's Bar for drinks and socializing and gathering. Bill's Bar has two entrances. One is from within the promenade that is underneath 30 Rock, and then one from 51st Street. So where we meet is on the lower level of Bill's Bar. There's a bar on the upper level of Bill's Bar, and there's a bar on the lower level. We meet at the bottom. So that is what the agenda is. Today's talks. We're going to have a talk from Mani Soundararajan, and yes, I do know how to pronounce that. And he's going to talk about Hubot, so that'll be fun. That'll be a quick talk. We're going to have a talk from Dave Johnson about theadvocate.com and some of the work they've been doing. And then we're going to have a newbie boff. So we didn't do this last time, but we've typically done this in the past. For those that don't know, whenever there are kind of newbies in the audience or people that have very, very specific questions, my site, you know, I need to do this. What's a good module to look at? What's a good resource? You know, where can I find some help on this? I usually do that, so I'm going to be doing that again today. I'm going to be doing it right out there in the lobby on the nice comfy couches that they have out there. I will wave and tell people that I'm kind of going in that direction when we do that at about 7:10, maybe 7:15 since we started a bit late. And around that time, we will also have our featured speaker this evening, or speakers, I should say, Diana Montalion. Yes. And Dominic Laycock from The Economist. They're going to be talking about a whole bunch of stuff they've been doing with decoupling stuff around The Economist website. So that should be very, very interesting. And those are the talks and buffs. We'll talk about this right here. Tonight's organizers, right? So we have a very dedicated group of people who have been spending a lot of time and energy organizing this meetup. Most of them are in the back there. Wave, yay. So if you're an organizer, if you see the people that are waving, if you have questions about the meetup or you want to suggest things about the meetup or you want to give feedback about the meetup, keep it to yourself. No, kidding. Find one of those people and let them know. Like I said before, the venue has been sponsored by NBCU Technology and our talent acquisition folks. So we thank them again. Yes. Yay! Interesting fact. So for those of you who haven't ever seen me give a presentation, I generally put an adorable, gratuitous photo of my kid. So that's what he'll be for Halloween this year. That's Henry. Isn't he cute? He's adorable. He's going to be a fire man, as he says it, so that'll be fun. Okay, so some interesting facts. Drupal NYC just reached our 1,000th member, so that's very cool. Big achievement for Drupal NYC. We have 1,000 members. That's pretty cool. At our last meetup, we had 94 attendees, and tonight's meetup, we had 130 RSVPs. We'll do a count informally a little bit later and see how well we did. Another interesting fact, just recently, Drupal 8 now has dynamic page cache enabled by default. So that's a cool feature that went into Drupal 8. So my 2 second thing about that, everybody knows that we cache a lot in Drupal, right? Try and make it faster. But it's always been a problem with those friggin' authenticated users that we can't cache anything for. Well, now we can. Can't cache everything, but we can cache a lot of things. So that means that pages are going to load a lot faster. So this is very cool. This is also kind of critical to some of the work that's been done on big pipe loading of pages in Drupal 8. And Drupal 8 really is quite a bit faster than any Drupal in history. So that's a cool, interesting fact. Yay. Photos. So we encourage everybody to take photos. If you do, please share them on either Twitter, hashtag DrupalNYC, or on meetup.com. And other places too. I don't know. I can't. Instagram? Let's say Instagram. But yes, please do take photos and share those with your friends and your neighbors. And upcoming events. Okay, so we always like to tout our brethren in the Drupal community. The Baltimore camp is October 9th coming up. The New England Drupal camp is October 10th, which I believe is actually in Providence. I think I spoke incorrectly last time. I think that I for some reason I thought it was New Hampshire, but I believe I looked it up and it's in Providence this year. What? It's October 10th. That was 4 days ago. So awesome. I heard it was fantastic. Moving right along. In 2 days, it is Drupal Camp Atlanta. So if you want to book a quick flight, Delta's hub is down there. So I bet it's like real easy to get tickets. Bay Area Drupal Bad Camp, which is one of the larger camps that we have every year, is coming up later in October. So that's pretty cool. And then finally, Drupal Camp New Jersey is a little closer to home. It's coming up on January 29th, and we have an esteemed member of the Drupal NYC community here, Peter Wolinen, who's going to take the mic for a minute and just give us a quick intro to Drupal Camp New Jersey.
Yay. Hey, everyone. So I have swag already here at the back. You have your choice of the Drupal Tiger, which is a morphing of the Princeton University logo and the DrupalCon. And our coffee pot last year, because you know diners are really famous in New Jersey and they have a lot of coffee and Drupal people drink a lot of coffee, so we thought we needed to combine those two themes together in one sticker. Anyway, so take one of those or both from the back if you haven't already. We basically run a very focused camp. We have 1 day of sessions, which is going to be January 30th, which is a Saturday. Session submissions will probably open quite soon. Right now we have a landing page site, which gives you basically the overview, but we don't have session submissions open yet, but we do have tickets open. And I say that because we have sold out every single year we've held this camp at least 2 weeks before the camp. So if you want to attend, I would recommend considering buying a ticket sooner than later. We'll be sending out an announcement as soon as session submissions are open. On the Friday before January 29th, we will be doing a full day of trainings. Those are low cost. We get trainers actually to donate their time, and we basically just charge for the food in the venue. So those have been around $80 for a full day training, which hopefully you guys think is a good price. And then Saturday the 30th will be a full day of sessions. The Sunday, we'll be doing sprinting. We may do some extended sprints Monday and Tuesday, which is not on schedule. We have Kathy is planning to come in from Chicago, Lori coming in from Finland, some other people that want to just hang out and code. So if you like are really into Drupal and just want to sit around and code like 3 days straight, you can do it with us. Anything else to say? Oh, and we have our keynote already lined up, which is great. So Mike Angelo, who does Drupal training for a living, he runs a Drupal Easy, I think, training program down in Florida. So he's going to be giving a keynote really on sort of connecting the notion of how contributing to Drupal, how working with community helps you develop your skills and helps improve your life and your job and all the other things. So hopefully that will be a good keynote based on his experience running those trainings and really helping a lot of people bridge that gap and develop their Drupal skills and give back to the community. All right. Hope you guys make it.
And it's going to be at Princeton?
At Princeton University in Easy Train right away.
Princeton University. All right, so we've got Drupal Camp New Jersey coming up in January. Awesome. Thank you, Peter. Okay, so interested in speaking? ? Anyone? Yes, right? All those who are interested in speaking at one of these monthly meetups or at any of the camps we do, please talk to Ben Jeavons. You can see him waving in the back there. Please, if you have any topic in particular that you're passionate about, he would love to hear your ideas. If you have a topic or interest that you would like someone else to talk about, he would be very interested in your ideas, and he knows lots of people, so he'll try and find someone to talk on that topic. So his email is up there. I'm sure he's on the Twitters and other places too. But please do contact Ben if you have a good idea for a lightning talk, for something a little bit more substantial, or something that you're just interested in general. Right? Awesome. Okay, so this is a quick, fun part of our evening. Who in the room, and if you would please like raise your hand, wave in the air, stand up for a second, who is looking for a job in the Drupal world? Or your next contract, or your next client? Right? All right, everybody, now keep your hands up one more second, right? Except you, because you work for me. Okay, who in the room is looking to hire a Drupal expert of some kind or another? Yes, everybody put around. Now, those two folks in the back there who are waving their hands, they're from NBC Talent Acquisition. So you should definitely go and talk to Victor and Marnie over there. All right? Yeah? Yeah. Okay. Yes. Okay. Because they bought you pizza, frankly. That's, you should at least go and say hello, right? Okay, so those of you who are looking to hire should look around and take note of those of people who are raising their hands. And those people who are raising their hands looking to get a job should take note of those people who are looking to hire. All right. Actually, real quick, those who are looking to hire, shout out what company you work for real fast.
Digital Pulp.
The Economist. Digital Pulp.
Phase 2.
Acquia. Who? Inflection. NBC Universal. All right. What's that?
The NSLS.
The NSLS, yes. Which stands for not something like something else.
If that's for the National Society of Leadership and Success.
The National Society of Leadership and Success. That's a very lofty sounding organization.
Yes,
I like it. Fantastic. Okay, thank you. All right, so for those of you who have been here in the past, we've done introductions and sometimes I've gotten some feedback that maybe it takes a little bit too long, so I just wanted to kind of open it up to the group. Not right now, we're not all going to shout out our opinions or anything, but I'm going to forego the introductions for today, and if you guys feel like that would be really useful and important, I would like the feedback that we should reinstate it, right? So please do tell me. At some point, they pull me aside and say, I know this wasn't the most popular thing, but you know, I really think that I get a lot out of that, or I find that very useful. And we will try and come up with a better, more time-efficient, but still equally useful way of doing things as far as introduction. So that's why that's kind of a funny little slide there. Sound good? Everyone okay with that? Yeah, I'm not going to get burned at the stake? No? Okay. All right. Awesome. All right, we're on to our first speaker. So, our first speaker is Mani Soundararajan, whose name I learned to pronounce perfectly the day he came in my office and said that he's going to another company. money. He's going to be talking about Hubot. Hubot, our newest team member. What's my blurb that I have here? Hubot is a friendly bot who will help you run Jenkins builds or move tickets in Jira or even merge pull requests in GitHub right from your chat room, Slack, HipChat, whatever. And Monty's going to show you how he does that in 8 minutes or less. So you have a couple minutes for questions. Come on up, Monty. Monty.
Should be able to stand here, or you can use this.
Well, I'm
good. That's good.
That's good. Yeah, okay. Can you hear me up? All right. Hey, everyone. I'm
Mani. I'm speed.
Is okay? All right. I'm Mani Soundararajan. I work for Syndivit. I'm MSound on Twitter, GitHub, Drupal, most places. I'm going to talk about Hubot. Hubot is a chatbot that was created by GitHub for their internal coordination across the team with their DevOps operations, like deploy and build and so on. And at some point of time, they said that it was a really good tool, so they open sourced it. And yeah, we're going to see how we're using Hubot in my company. So it's a chatbot, right? So it integrates with various chat applications using what is called adapters. So we have adapters for Slack, HipChat, IRC. There are many, many adapters for whatever chat application you're using. So typically, when Slack first came out, we were all using it as a sort of an information sink. So you would have information coming from various applications into Slack, like somebody opened a pull request, or somebody opened a ticket on Jira, or Jenkins has successfully completed a build. So it used to be an information sink, and to the point that people stopped looking at Slack because it was just scrolling with so much information, right? So what Hubot does is turns that on its head and makes Slack as an information source, where that is where your origin is for various operations on GitHub, Jira, and Jenkins, right? So when you do this, you get a really good communication in your team, and you have a more a complete conversation in Slack when your team members are interacting and doing various operations. We'll see some of the examples. So here's an example of me building a job in Jenkins. So in this case, our Hubot is called Synbot because I work for Syndivit. But you can call your Hubot whatever you want. So it's a simple command, Synbot Jenkins build, and then the name of your job. And it's going to immediately start building it. And you see that in 5.5 seconds, Jenkins has finished it. So what Hubot does here is basically act as an interface between me and Jenkins, and I do it right from my chat application, right? The other thing is, once Hubot kicks off the job, it's not really Hubot's job to track that. It's Jenkins who is reporting back that the job is successful, right? We can, if we want, go into Slack and hack that and make it as though Hubot is reporting back success, but we decided to leave it as Jenkins. So Hubot is starting off the job and Jenkins is reporting the success of that job. So this command is really long to type, right? Synbot Jenkins build job name. Hubot also allows you to create shortcuts. So we've created a shortcut bang QA. And so anytime someone wants to build the QA server, reinstall Drupal and run a set of tests, all it takes is these three characters and it's all done. And the main benefit of doing this is the conversation that your team has around having Hubot commands, right? So you have a more complete conversation. Somebody fixed a bug and said that, okay, yeah, now I fixed the bug, I pushed it to GitHub, and then the QA person is like, thank you, I'm going to build a QA server. So the whole team knows what is happening in terms of the workflow, right? So the developer, the QA person, and Synbot, they're all having a conversation here, at the end of which the QA person decides they need to build a QA server, they do bang QA, and Synbot, Hubot starts building the QA server, right? So this is a good example of a team communication, right? You can also do integration with GitHub. We have a shortcut command for postpone. So in this case, you see it's postpone 290. That's a pull request. So as soon as I run the command, you see a label being attached that this pull request has been postponed. We have a lot of labels internally to help classify pull requests, thanks to inspiration from Eric, who came up with these for Flow. We also have reject, so you can do this right from your chat application. You could do reject 320, and that pull request is rejected. It's taken out of the QA server. You can also do integration with Jira. This is a plugin I wrote. So you could say that I'm working on issue 850, and the whole team now knows that this is what I'm working on. And Hubot immediately says, OK, I'm setting that to in progress. So the workflow is also tracked in Jira, and immediately you can see in Jira that, you know, the ticket has moved from to in progress. And when I'm done, I say, I'm done with this. I spend 10 minutes, right? So it's like the issue is marked as done. I added 10 minutes to the work log. Work log is something, it's very difficult for developers to go back and fill, and most of the time Scrum Masters are after them to like have you fill the work log. But developers don't like to fill it. But this is, makes it very easy to fill the work log. It's just one command. You can also create shortcuts if you want for this. So other than what you've seen in terms of integration with Jenkins, Jira, GitHub, there are a lot of fun things you can do. Hubot can do Google translations. Right from your chat application. It can create a Google map if you want. We just say map me 30 Rock and you get a map of that. You can say bug me, it gives you an image of a bug. Can it do memes? That's the important question. Yeah, it can. Like, all you have to do is type out what you want, it'll create on the fly the meme and display it. So what is this built on? Hubot is built on Node.js and CoffeeScript. I know a lot of PHP developers are here, don't freak out. CoffeeScript is like the love child of Python and JavaScript. So if you sort of know JavaScript, you can easily pick up CoffeeScript. It's really nice syntax without all the curly brackets. It's nice. I picked it up in like a half a day and wrote my own plugin. It's quite simple. Give it a go, it's really fun to work with. There are tons of plugins, so before you start writing your own plugin, just have a look at npmjs.com, see if a plugin already exists for what you're trying to do. And if it doesn't, then of course, go ahead and write your own plugin. Like in this case, I have 1,400 plugins. That's about what I wanted to say. Thank you.
All right, does anybody have any questions for Mani about Hubot? Comments, concerns, jokes, poems, haikus. No, we have it. Okay. Hold on 1 second.
You have security from this, right? I mean, there would be privileges attached, so not. I mean, everyone should be able to do deployments,
right. So,
but not everyone can.
Yeah. So the way we've done it is all the integration happens via OAuth tokens. So you go to GitHub, you create a token, and you give what permissions you want to give on that token. Give that token, hand it over to Synbot, Hubot. And then so all the operations are running as you, right? So it's everyone's individual account, they create a token. So you go to github.com, create a personal access token, and give specific permissions to read a repo, write to a repo, and so on. And same for Jira, and same for Jenkins. So basically, every user has to make their own token and hand over the token to the bot.
All right, anyone else? Yeah? Yeah? Or are you just trolling me?
Okay.
So is Hubot Turing test compatible?
I'm sorry, what is
it? Does it pass Turing test?
The Turing test.
Is it Turing?
We should try that. I don't know.
We should.
Yeah.
All right. I think we're going to wrap that one up. That was a great question to end on. Thank you very much, Mani. Awesome. Everybody go install Hubot. Get that set up. I just wanted to take an informal poll for a reason that has nothing to do with anything. How many people in the room who run Drupal sites use Jenkins to kick off your cron? Just curious. Okay, that was it, thanks. Awesome, all right, our next lightning talk is gonna be given by Dave Johnson. He's from advocate.com. or he's talking about advocate.com, which was recently relaunched. And he's specifically talking about issues with front-end modifications, content migration. It's up there, yeah. Content migration, changes in traffic patterns, ad inventory, shared modules, and syndication. Dave is a designer and developer. He has clients including Viacom, MTV, Showtime, AOL, Out and Advocate magazines. He's currently creative director, digital media, and at Here Media. And this is an interesting one. I've never seen this one before, but this is cool. In addition to his web work, Dave has worked in interactive television and video games and has several games in the permanent collection at the Smithsonian. I'm really fascinated to hear about this afterwards when we're all going to ask him about what these games are. But in the meantime, Dave Johnson's going to come on up and talk to us about advocate.com. Here he is. And we'll switch the input in the back. Here we go. No whammies, no whammies. All right.
Okay. Can you hear? So first, a little background. The company is Here Media. Obviously, it's a media company. We have 9 brands. We specialize in the LGBT market. It's a niche market, but it's also a very attractive market. We have terrific advertisers. We have some print properties. Out Magazine is one. We get great people. Tiffany, Gucci, Tommy. Look at the picture. So it's pretty high-end stuff. So it's really blue-chip advertisers, both on print and in digital. So these are the 9 properties. Recently moved them all onto Drupal. They were all over the place. We took, bought some of them. We had the custom backend. We had Ektron and all kinds of horrible stuff. The past 2 years, we got them all onto Drupal 6. We're now in the process of moving them to Drupal 7. We moved out in January, and I actually gave a presentation. I think maybe some of you saw the beta version of out. That was in January of 2015. We moved Advocate to D7 on September 8th, and we moved SheWard last night, 2 o'clock in the morning. So if I'm a little bleary-eyed, you'll have to forgive me for that. So I'll show you a little bit, starting with Advocate. So this is the homepage of Advocate. It's obviously fully responsive. We used, just show you the whole, you know, liquid sort of mobile version. We use a lot of material design. I don't know if people are familiar with Google Material Design. It uses this card system. You see all these tiles. This is considered an introduction to a piece of content. So we stripped it down. You have a guy's photo, you have the category, you have a headline, you have a timestamp, and you have the level of engagement in social media, which hopefully is higher. You can see some of them are not great, but we can get thousands in some of the stories. So this is all the home page, and we have similar format for out, slightly bigger photos. They have better photography. They have better access to photography, so they want to show that off a little bit more. But we're going to all basically the same format for all of the 9 sites. Bootstrap 3, people are probably familiar with. Salvatore on top of that, which gives us this sort of liquid Tetris kind of aspect going. We also changed, and I'm going to show you one of the older sites up here. This is a D6 site. And if you see the top navigation here, this is your standard sort of drop-down navigation, very sort of classic academic hierarchy. We really got away from that. People we found just don't click on this. They don't care. It's not interesting. So we went back to a more of a topic-based taxonomy, which is, you know, something like election, Hillary Clinton. All of a sudden, people will click on that. They won't click on a basic taxonomy. So we switched all of that over.
We also want to standardize image size, 4:3 aspect ratio for all of the sites, which allows us to syndicate very easily between all of the sites. We can now, within CMS, just say, we like this story on out, we want to send it to Advocate, it just goes perfectly, really, really smoothly. There's one other, so this is all the home page. So this is great, we love it, it has an infinite scroll, gives us tons of ad inventory. If you see, ads will just show up in here, it keeps going and going. I'm going to switch back to one little chart here. And this is Advocate in 2011. I don't know, can you see that? Yeah, 2011. This blue is the home page in 2011. This blue is the home page in 2015. And I think anyone who works on a media site has probably seen this, and this is obviously from social media. So all of this great stuff you do on the homepage, and you work, and everyone, you know, obsesses about the homepage. That's the number one thing that people want to talk about. We're, especially on desktop, we're down to 3% of our audience sees the homepage. That's because everyone is going to social media, and they want to see all of this. These are our story templates. So what do you do? I mean, you put all this great work into the homepage. So we take that, and let's just go to a standard story page. And we get an interstitial ad. And this is out. It might be a little slow. Let's go back to out again. So what do? We take our basic components from the home page, which is our editor's picks up here. This is curated. And put our content in here. Here's our regular story. And then we take our latest news and put it into that same template. So now your landing page, which used to be the home page, I mean, 5 years ago that was the number one page, is now your story page, so you take all the great stuff from your page, obviously, and you put it on the story page. So that's a real sea change, I think, for a lot of media companies. And you still see people obsessing about the homepage. All they talk about, the homepage. You see executives sitting at their desk, desktop homepage. They forget about mobile, number one, and story pages. I mean, this is really a major template. And it took us a while to sort of get that through our heads. And it's been very, very successful, not only in terms of traffic, but just inventory. So you see this infinite scroll, great ads just keep going and going and going. The other cool thing about this is we use a lazy load. So as you're loading, as you're scrolling down, the only time an ad shows up is when it actually loads, so that you know that you've got viewability. It's not like down here, so that the advertiser is saying, we don't want to pay for that, it's below the fold, that kind of thing. As soon as it loads, we're able to charge for the impression because it's actually visible. A couple of other things we did in general, we removed pagination from story pages, which is a little scary. I think page views are still a metric that people, you know, toss around. I don't know how valid it really is anymore. We really try and talk more about ad inventory and impressions, but page views, people still, they still like to talk about it. So it's a little scary to not have any pages, because obviously you're not going to get page views. So that's kind of it. That's the main changes that we made. And also the fact is that we're moving this, doing this across all of the sites, so they're all going to be syndicatable. And when we do a new feature, we can share the module, and it happens across all of the 9 sites.
All right, thank you very much, Dave. Does anybody have any questions about the recent work that was done by Dave that he was showing off here? We have a question right here.
I have the mic now.
Oh, go. Do it.
So, do you guys need support for A/B testing of headlines or photos or anything like that?
You know, hopefully, and this is one of those things, you know, it's always about resources. I think once we get everything onto D7, that's something we would love to do. you know, sometimes we feel like we're just treading water like everyone else. But yet, once we get everything onto D7 and we have all the shared modules and we can do a feature across the board, yeah, we'd love to do it.
Can you say again the cart system you said was something from Google?
Yeah, I mean,
can you talk a little bit more about what the name of that was and how that's integrated with the site theme?
Well, material design is really, Google's not noted for interface design, except lately I think they've gotten much, much better. Their mobile stuff is really good. The Android stuff is good. Some of their newer products like Google Play, much, much nicer. And it's not just about the aesthetics. We all talk about like flat icons and all that kind of stuff. This card system, and I hate to say this because it was really developed for Google Glass, which is not exactly the best recommendation, but that was something that really, it really turned me on because it was a way to introduce a piece of content. If you think of it as a calling card, not a playing card, a calling card, this is an introduction. And this is the same content that we share. It goes out to Facebook. It's the same thing. It's a head, it's the category, it's a timestamp, it's the level of interaction and the photo. And so that's the card that just goes out into the world everywhere. It just gets syndicated. And that's what Google sort of came up with. And we thought it was a great idea, and we went with it.
One more, last one.
Mm-hmm.
Two more.
Since obviously the different magazines or the different sites are supposed to have distinctive, followings, the fact that you're sharing the same content and it looks like the same card on the different sites, does that not counteract the attempt of being, you know, individualized?
Yeah, sort of, maybe. And that's an internal debate. I mean, there were brand managers who were like really, really opposed to this. Our site has to be exactly like this. We did use different fonts. We try and make them a little bit distinctive. Users don't care. They just don't care. In fact, they prefer to have a consistent interface. They don't want to go to a new site and say, how do I use this one? It's all different. Where's my button? So we're actually, internally, we get so close to it and we think, oh, they all look the same. Users, you know, they see the difference and they also check. I just don't think they care that much. So they just want to see a piece of content. They want to see a cool story.
You talk about taxonomy. Did you modify the menu based on taxonomy?
Yeah, I mean, I showed you the earlier one. This is our old D6, and this was the classic. I mean, this almost mimics like the sitemap. You know, this is very hierarchical, very academic. We found that users just never click on it. I mean, it's nice in our heads to keep it organized, and we still have it there. It still exists in the background. I forgot to show you one thing. We still have the hamburger menu, so we still have a classic taxonomy here. And the people who love this, and in fact, it's more prominent on out, advertisers want this. Advertisers want to see fashion. This is a vertical. They want to see lifestyle, they want to see travel. I mean, this is really for the advertisers. They want to go to the Travel Channel and they want to say, what kind of travel content do you have? Users, maybe they'll go to travel, but maybe most of them want to go to Beyonce. You know, that's what they just want to click on. They want to click on a celebrity.
Thank you very much. All right. Awesome. So next up, we're going to have some folks from The Economist come up. Diana Montalion.
You were better the first time. I say Montalion, but
Montalion.
I made it up, so you can say whatever you like.
All right, well, I'm going to try. Montalion, we'll go with that. And Dominic Laycock. What's my blurb that I have? It's up there? It's up there. Yes. The Economist currently served by Drupal 6. That's right, Drupal 6, everybody. I'm pretty sure for a long time, probably still, it was the largest site on Drupal 6. I don't know. And it's getting bigger every day. So I'm not going to go through everything, but the back end is still Drupal 6 with an API added to deliver JSON. The mid-tier microservices layer uses Golang. The decoupled component-based front end uses Node.js and React. So there you guys are going to get into all this good stuff during the presentation. Awesome. So Dominic is the technology manager for the Economist NYC team and the solution architect for the Drupal aspect of this project. And Diana is a veteran of many enterprise Drupal projects, currently working with the Economist team to architect and implement this revamp. And little known fact, they're married.
And they gave us a clicker to fight over, so and you get to watch that.
Fantastic.
We've only been married a month, so we don't know how to do this.
Oh, they're newlyweds. Congratulations. okay, so Diana and Dominic, are going to get started. Real quick before they get started, I'm going to be heading off into the lobby for the newbie bop. If anybody has real specific questions about something that I can help answer, come find me back there. Otherwise, get ready for the fun and excitement that The Economist has to offer. Here we go.
So we have these, so I think I don't need these. I think we do need these. We don't need these. Okay.
Put this right here. Don't tell anyone.
Okay. Okay. I don't do hardware, so give me a sec. Let's see if I can make this work. I also remember to turn off Slack channels and other ways of out of the box. Okay. How about that? Wait a minute.
That was perfect.
Okay. This works. Okay? Okay. All right. So, we're going to tell you in a second who we are, but I always like to ask a question to get to know you. And apparently, according to Twitter, I ask the most annoying question because I usually ask an American football question. I once gave a session to 200 people and asked who was playing on Sunday night football. No one in the room knew. There was a right answer and a wrong answer because the Pats were playing the Colts. And so someone tweeted, "This is why I love Drupal. No one in the room watches football." Does anybody watch football? No, see, this is, so we have an office pool and there were 50 people that started, there were only 6 of us left. So I'm feeling pretty.
Some of us went out in week 1, so not.
Okay, so we're gonna talk to you, there's a lot of things happening in the next year or so at The Economist. There's been a lot of work over the last year to strategize. There's a relatively new CTO, when did Mark start?
I'm going to say 6 months ago.
But yeah, kind of knew it. The CTO, who we work for and who has a great and a very expansive vision. And so that's what we're going to talk about. So we're going to talk a little bit about why The Economist came to this point. And then towards the end, we'll focus into specifically the technology related to Drupal. So who we are, you get to go first.
I'm Dominic Laycock. And technology manager, which basically means that I look after our CMS platform. So that's primarily the economist.com, which runs on Drupal 6.
And Diana, you can mention, say my name however. I guess what's interesting to say about me. So I started as a back-end developer in the Drupal shops. I've worked predominantly in the Drupal shops. I played a number of different, I'll call them escalating roles, leadership roles since then, and now I was taking 3 months off until The Economist made me an offer I couldn't refuse. So now I'm with them, and I don't think it's going to be 3 months working on this project.
And we have to give thanks to Mark, who's the CTO, for letting us use and adapt his very nice presentation.
Yeah, because we suck at slides. So the project involves the internal backend team, which is us, and another developer named Shada Ram, who has been around, who has been working on the Economist code since before Drupal, when it was Cold Fusion.
13 years. And then also there's the internal front end team, which are mainly London based. They work very closely with our editorial teams, and they're headed up by Angela Ripley.
And there are most of, there's a team, there are people all over the world actually working on this project. That I think we can say for sure. Right now, the leads on the team are holed up in a little tiny room in London, and they feed them and otherwise have them write code all day. So there's a few other companies involved, ThoughtWorks, working predominantly on the mid-tiers, you'll see. Wildy, that's what we say, depends on who you ask how they pronounce it. CloudReach for SysOps mostly, and Eden Speakerman is working on user experience and design. And we invited them all here, but alas, it's 1 o'clock in the morning for them. Okay, so as I said, what we're going to cover is take a brief look at the Economist and the platforms and how it's changing to enable digital transformation. Now, 2 years ago when people started using digital transformation, I was like, boo, marketing speak. But now I actually really like the phrase. I really think that it says a lot about how, the synergy between the technical team and the business side team and the values or the mission of projects. And plus, it's what I find interesting. We'll talk about what the technical vision is, then the revamp project specifically, and how Drupal even more specifically plays a role. And then if we have time, which we might not, there is actually one or two other simultaneous projects that are equally complex and interesting. So if we get there, we'll talk a little about those.
So,
look, I generously offered it to you. Yes.
So what sets the Economist apart? A lot of media companies are now in this space and the sort of process of some form of digital transformation. So when do you stop becoming a print magazine and start becoming something else? And internally we talk a lot about five factors, which are these. And these are things that we look for in all products that are put out by The Economist. So we're smart, we're a trusted filter, we have bold ideas and we'll really push the agenda, particularly where it leads to positive change. And we're truly a global publication, so we cover events that happen throughout the world. And overall, you know, we have some really great editorial staff that produce wonderful content.
My favorite, this slide makes me think that The Economist was pro-gay marriage before gay marriage was cool. So the way that they view themselves, and this is what leads the technology decisions, right? They're the antidote for information overload, right? That they distill information into finishable packages, not quick headline-bait packages, but actually dive in and be able to understand something much more deeply from having spent time engaging with their content. And they're doing this by offering a number of different ways of interacting with the content, although of course the long-term goal is to have even more. So there's The Economist magazine, right? That's the weekly publication that, how long since the 1880s? Ooh, I shouldn't have put you on the spot like that. So the Economist app, so that you can get for iOS or Android. There's the Espresso app, which is relatively new, and that gives you daily headlines. So a little bit to start your day and get a sense of what's going on in the world. Economist.com, which is the primary digital product that people most associate. There's two editorially driven newsletters I was going to say something, but I'm not sure I'm right, so I won't say it. And then the Global Business Review, which we'll talk about later, that's the first Economist multilingual experience. And they went multilingual Chinese. I'm like, what happened to the training wheels of like Spanish? And then, you know, Chinese, but go big.
So I've been asked to speak into the microphone because I'm a softly spoken Brit, so the biggest microphone in the world. Our current content platform, like I said, is primarily the main website is theeconomist.com, which is a Drupal 6 website. We transitioned from a completely custom CMS using ColdFusion, Windows servers, Oracle databases to standardize on Drupal, and that launched around 2010, and we'll cover a little bit of what that involves. So we have around 40 different content types and 500,000 nodes. And we built custom import to pull in from our print magazine and automatically create article nodes based off that. And workflow supporting that, allowing the production team to go in and position images, all that standard stuff. We built metered paywalls. We built access for bulk subscribers and admin tools to manage those. There's whole subsections of the site which are separate businesses that are part of the Economist group, like Which MBA and Economist Events. There's third-party integrations, so we push content up to a newsletter provider and also push it up to APIs to do semantic tagging to figure out what topics content relates to. User registration and login is still in Drupal, and that's 8 million registered users, which is a force to be reckoned with, particularly when you're trying to run a local database. Manage My Account is all in the customer service tools, which allows a third-party company to help us provide customer service. We have comments, and as with most things that we did in Drupal, we had to do it a little bit differently. So we have featured comments. We have custom sort options that sort comments by most recommended, and abuse moderation tools that again allow third-party companies to help make sure that the site doesn't get spammed or that there isn't any particularly malicious profanity or anything like that going on. We have APIs. So Drupal also is providing APIs for native apps, for third-party sites, for point-of-sale subscriptions. So whenever someone buys a subscription to The Economist, that will create a user in the Drupal database. And we have themes, a desktop theme and a mobile theme. So really the point here is we started off with just articles and blogs and built and built and built. And they're around 400.
Oh, I was going to ask them as a quiz. What would you say is a lot of modules to run on a Drupal site?
400.
Yay! There are 400 modules running on the site.
And do you want to guess how many of them are custom?
300.
Between 200 and 300 of those modules are custom.
Because we didn't bother counting, but somewhere in between there.
Roughly. Yeah. Sometimes you just don't know anymore. So all that to say that all this functionality is in one single code base. So whenever we have a new project, be it we want to do a mobile optimized site, or we want a responsive site, or in this case, we want to talk about decoupling, the question will invariably come up, do we want to build this off Drupal 6, or do we want to migrate to Drupal 8? And unfortunately, for sites of this size, moving to Drupal 8 is always going to be a rebuild job. And with the amount of functionality that's in the code base, that's going to be a really tough endeavor. But...
Has anyone here actually worked on the Drupal code base?
I see a few.
It's not surprising that you go to a session and you ask people and there's somebody in the room that at some point has been in some place that then they did some work on.
Often this happens at cons. I turn up at cons and people tell me that they work at The Economist on their Drupal sites and I've never seen them. And some of the reason why that happens is here. So in addition to the main Drupal 6 website, we also have a large number of D7 sites that were built, some by third-party companies, some internally. So we have The World In, which is a sister publication of The Economist and does predictions for the years coming, for the year ahead, rather. And that's a D7 site that supports a PugPig native app. We also have a debate site, which is an Oxford-style debate. So there's a proposition and debate backwards and forwards. Espresso that we mentioned earlier, that's the daily app, also is a Drupal 7 instance, and The World If, which we'll cover in a bit more detail later on. And a couple of redesigns underway as well for Economist Events and for More Intelligent Life.
So I'm going to tell you what the challenges are, but I think that it's inherent in the explanation of where we are right now. So it's inflexible and slow, right? Slow, so by today's standards, people fuss about the page load slowness, but in fact, it has traditionally been pretty fast for a site doing that much. But what happens, what happens over time is we can just pop in this JavaScript that does this, and we can just pop in this JavaScript that does this, and I think there are 75,000 bits of JavaScript interacting with the entire internet every time, not really, but that's kind of what it feels like. So as the site has grown, so have the challenges and the inflexibility. When you initially architect an enterprise site, you've got this huge space that you can work in. And over time it goes like this, right? Because over time every feature that gets integrated has to work with everything else and not break anything else, right? So that's what you expect. 5 years for an application like this is actually quite a good life. And it's not dying either now. That's not the plan, as you'll see. The plan was not to take it out back and shoot it. Well, some days that's the plan, but that's not the overall vision. So the data's in silos. So I feel like this is the most important thing, right? What's the essential value is the content, right? And all of the wisdom and work that goes into the content. And now the content, as you can see from the previous slides, is spread out, right, in different places. And now sites have to sort of kind of talk to each other and maybe a little bit cooperate, right? Because it's an older application, so our question is, like, raise your hand if you'd be very excited about taking a new job working on an enterprise Drupal 6 site.
Anyone?
We're going to ask you to raise your hand again when we're done, though. There's a lot of rework to make. Every time you do something, you have to also refactor other things, and then you also have to adapt whatever the vision is to make it fit within the parameters, which you have to do for every project. But that's become particularly constricting. Oops. Oh, what did I do? Oh, good. Ooh. Ooh, I can do that. That's fun. And then it's tightly coupled, right? So Dom went through the whole list of all of the things that the site is providing, and these things are all woven together. And because Drupal, which is both a good thing and a challenging thing, they all happen, bootstrap, and everything has to happen at the exact same time, right? So there's a lot of challenges around with the timing of things and the ability to integrate this without hurting that. Yeah? Okay. So what we're trying to achieve. Now, and so for me, one of the things that I really like about this project, I focused on a lot in my career. Like when I first started building Drupal sites, it's what happened was I downloaded Drupal, I started playing with it, I really liked it, so the next client I had said, I have this problem, and I said, I have this solution, because I wanted, and Drupal was a good solution for them, but also because I wanted to play with Drupal. And so in the first few years, the technology would lead the solution. Like, I have this technology, how can I apply it to problems? And that's still a relevant question. But one of the things that I really like about the way that the broader team is approaching this project is what's the problem from a business standpoint, and not just the business standpoint, but from a vision standpoint and from a cultural value standpoint. So we really know. And for the Economist, that's relatively easy because the number one thing is to have more people reading the content, right? Boom, that's it. And then, beyond that, of course, then there's a turnover of subscriptions, right? And especially to reach subscriptions to reach into areas that they have not been. Like I think the CEO, when we talked to us originally in the first couple of days about China, and that's why the app is translated. And then increasing advertising inventory, which will always, I think, be the case for all publications. And then a better content system on which to build. Now, this is kind of this is an interesting question, and I think when we were talking about this in the elevator, right? The question of, well, why can't it be more like WordPress, right? Because WordPress is just very joyful to put content in. Drupal maybe not quite so much joyful, or it can be. So, but it's not just that, it's the ability to, it's going to be interesting to see what the differences are between the editorial experience of adding content and also how much that's just simply inhibited by how many content types, 400 different content types. Like, you know, what? How do you meet in the middle to have a content platform that's both technologically flexible, but also enjoyable to have it be at an enterprise level where content is the focus? And so the big thing, right? Harness the power of the content. How do we harness the power that is inherent in this product?
Just to go over a few things that, you know, are part of the strategy of how we build products. We recently migrated our economist.com to AWS. So in general, we embrace the cloud. We look for services, and we tend to buy commodity and focus our internal development teams on building innovation. So this is really, you know, we don't want to reinvent the wheel with the internal development teams. If we can buy a service, we will do so and leverage the experience of our internal teams to actually build things that are new and interesting. We focus a lot on cross-functional teams, lean startup style concepts of how can we test this idea out with the minimum amount of work, prove that it works, prove that it delivers value, and iterate based off that. And generally, you know, we focus on delivering a content, leveraging it, and using that content, reusing that content to create products with an exceptional user experience.
Which is different than, you know, the point of 5 or 6 years ago was to build a website, right? You build a website that did what you needed to do. Now the focus is delivering your content to whomever is going to consume it, right? So, okay. So we say decoupled 2.0, the world if, because the world in was actually the first attempt at decoupling, and it was a very, very much kind of how you'd expect it, right? Was it Node as well?
No, so the world in was, when in the Drupal community we talk about decoupling, there's inevitably a percentage of the audience that will be talking about, I want an app that consumes off a CMS. Right, so that's the world in. So we use PugPig as the native app framework, and it consumes from a Drupal 7 CMS, fairly standard stuff. So decoupled 2.0
is the world if, and this is what I think of when I think of decoupled, which is this is a node front end. Use React too, right?
Yeah.
Using the React framework. That is using content, but delivering it not associated with the Drupal theme, right? So the Drupal theme is not involved in this. And it's component-based, which is a word that the front-end team uses a lot. And I kind of sort of get that, but I think until I would actually work on the front-end, which is very interesting because I think there, you know, originally in hiring, the question was, are you looking for a back-end person or a front-end person? And my feeling was, you know, you go across the stack. Like, you can cross-browser test, and you should be able to write a MySQL query. Like, that was sort of my in-between. Now, there's stuff that the other teams do. They use words I don't even know. Like, that, and that's, I think, part of what really drives the strategy of cross-functional teams, right? Because the, you know, more and more front-end developers now are front engineers, right? They're engineering on the front end, we're engineering on the back end. And so the thing that was people really liked about this, right, is it's a lot faster, right? That's what most of the things are, a lot faster. To which we fuss a little bit and say, yes, but it's not running the 752,432 JavaScript app. Scripts that have to run on the, but it's, I think the people talk about this, their experience, their seamless experience, they talk about it. From my point of view, one of the best things that came out of this is it really got everyone a taste of what can happen if we continue on with a project as big as the one that we're about to describe to you, right? Like, I can explain technologically, like, we know we can't stay on on Drupal 6. We know that. And there's a lot of architecture, even if it was a straight migration to Drupal 8, there's a lot of work. But this plan is actually more complex than that. And one of the things that I really like about the World In is that the people that needed to be behind this plan, we could iterate and deliver something small. The front end team, I shouldn't say we, because I had absolutely nothing to do with this, and it's beautiful. The front end team could iterate on something small and deliver it, and that agility was also very attractive. So this was the pinky toe in the water.
Was indeed. So.
This is me.
It is.
Yeah, but you can if you want. Up. You didn't like this slide, so I don't want to stick you with it.
Okay.
So I put this here because we're gonna look at a picture of what the revamp project is. But now there's the, okay, we can do this. How do we really do this? So the revamp project now will split the Economist experience into three tiers. So the front end tier is much like you see with the world. With the World If, except much more robust, right? And then on the back end is Drupal delivering JSON as the content, right? So it's the content repository. And of course, not just the Drupal 6 site that's drupal.com, but it can then be any content repository that we want to integrate. And then there's a mid-tier service being built in Go that takes, basically, Drupal says, here you go, here's all the things you'd ever want to know about a node, forever and ever, here's the whole node object. And then the mid-tier service says, well, what's usual and customary if people want blog content? What do they need the date it was created, the title, the fly title, the body, all of that. And those microservices then deliver to any front end that is going to consume the content. And now, because the front end is in node, or in this case, the front end is a node, they can decide to display or not display the content that they get. So what this does is it pushes the logic where the decisions should get made, right? So the content repository makes certain decisions about what it offers up. The mid-tier service makes certain decisions about what standardization. There's also a story in this sprint to look at the structured content, the topicizing of the content happening in the mid-tier instead of in Drupal, because that can vary depending on many things. And then the front ends can be you know, economist.com, but the front ends can also be five articles on Facebook, right? The front end can be any consumer of the Economist content. So now you can do the pretty pictures, because that's the best part.
So what does it look like? We spoke about having Drupal acting as the content repository and exposing to microservices. And we can imagine there may be a microservice around blog content, some around print articles, more services around comments. Images certainly would warrant a microservice, if not more than one microservice. you know, responsive images, yay. And exposing those, oops, okay, to a front-end experience. And as we said, the front-end experience is basically component-based. So imagine every page not as a entire page, but broken down into the individual components that make up that page. So if we focus on building those individual components and creating a library of those components, then the aspiration is that what we get is the ability to build new products that incorporate some of those components. So it means that instead of rebuilding every time a login form, or rebuilding every time a widget that exposes the top five pieces of content, we get to focus purely on the bits that are missing from a new site that we're going to be building. So that would be E in this case. And then, like we said, the eventual aim is that we incorporate some of the other Drupal repositories and we break down those silos. So all the Drupal sites that we have, all the content that we have across the business would be exposed to the same microservices, so that we can, for example, grab content from the print edition with a couple of blog posts and the latest content from the Espresso app and deliver that to a new product.
Yeah, the Espresso app is because of the siloed data. The things you see in the Espresso app, which is very popular, is not part of .com content. They actually don't, at the moment, interact with each other, which is
fixable. So, what would that look like in terms of actually building it?
Unless you want.
Over to Diane. No,
you can go. I don't want it. It's like, okay, all right. Okay, so this is the evolution. So right now, this is .com, right? .com is the back end, the middle end, and the front end of everything, right? And so so what we're doing now, like not right this second because we're giving a talk, but like in general this week, what we're doing now is we're building the infrastructure to deliver the content to microservices. So then microservices can deliver the content to the front end. So we, this original image that Dom showed you, that's the end game, right? At the moment, the MVP, and so we talked about this, embracing the idea of MVE and MVP to be able to iterate and get, do user testing, get some game, what's the user experience for doing this so that we can adapt quickly. So right now, primarily, it's about delivering blogs and the images that go with them, because images, yay, are so much fun and neat. And also, so one of the joys is that on The Economist, in the body text, images that show in the body text are actually translated using a module that I will fuss about, but not here, are translated to have a unique ID stored in their own table. So when we give the mid-tier the blog content, it has these IDs that link to images that are in the CCK fields, but there's no, because CCK, because Drupal 6, that there's no way to know which one thing means which thing. So we're writing an endpoint this week that lets them give us back that ID, and then we tell them how that matches their the image. So these are some of the workarounds that we have to do because of where we're started. But we'll tell you later how we're managing the Drupal architecture, because what we don't want to happen is have it turn into, well, we need this edge case. Will you build something that delivers this edge case? Right? So we'll tell you how we're protecting against that, though it will still, the dam will break. It will still happen. Right? Then we move on to something else. I think articles is the next thing that we're considering looking, because comments frighten me. Okay, so one of the things that happened, for those of you that do, this has come up a number of times, but when Ron Kasher, who's the mid-tier architect, when he first showed us the diagram, that was what the slide that Dom showed you before. Let me go back to that because I think it makes the point here. Okay, so he showed us this, but in our technical diagram, there's Drupal, there's caching, there's mid-tier, there's caching, there's front-end, there's caching. There's three Varnish instances, two Varnish or one, and we just freaked out. We're like, we can't even get the views caching to cooperate with giving output that's been changed in the last year. Like, that's been our primary, like, you just see this diagram with layers of caching in between it and how we have to then programmatically make sure that we've cleared the cache when any change has gotten made. And there's no push notification, right? So right now, the way that it'll work is the mid-tier has to ask, has there been a change, right? But which is fine unless the mid-tier comes and says, has there been a change, and we give the cached version, right? So, sorry. I couldn't make it through the night without a cache rant. I'm sorry.
That's quite a bit.
I don't think it'll be the last. So this is silly. How'd that happen? I'm talking too much. Yes. Well,
So just to finish off on the previous slide, the idea that we saw here is as we get to the point where we're building out the MVE or the MVP into the new economist.com, what happens is Drupal goes away, right? And then we end up in this architecture where Drupal is only being the content repository and there's no longer front-end content being served by Drupal. It's all through the new front-end experience. So at this point, we have some interesting options because now we know that instead of having to migrate everything, comments, print edition, all the things that we mentioned before, we can just focus on this one connection between Drupal and the microservices tier.
And this is, so this is how we're solving the Drupal 6 problem, right? Is that we're not doing anything in Drupal 6. We're piece by piece exposing the content and exposing the behaviors that are happening in Drupal 6. And then when we make a migration, we've decoupled all that tightly coupled functionality so that when we do that, there's much lower risk to everything falling apart or to having a 6-month migration from Cold Fusion to Drupal 6 take 2.5 years. Not that that would happen on any project. So the question that comes up is, so are we going to migrate to Drupal 8? Right? And what I can say is that that's a very real possibility that's on the table, right? But it's a conversation that won't get too deep until early next year. So what we'll do is focus on proving this architecture, right? And building this architecture and let Drupal 8 ripen a little bit. And this question is going to be driven mostly by, so the authoring experience, performance, all of these questions will get considered. But Drupal 8 is certainly something that open source and Drupal 8 is certainly a high contender for that to happen.
What we can say for sure is that we won't be rebuilding the monolithic one code base approach. So it's very much Drupal 8 as a content authoring experience and other components more focused on a service-based approach.
And the content authoring experience now can happen in other content authoring platforms and still then be shared as part of an Economist product, right? So it gives us some flexibility about different kinds of content and authoring. So I had said that these are some of the architectural decisions that we made really early on about the Drupal code, right? And the first one was don't break .com. So in the first sprint, that's exactly what I did. So I wrote a views endpoint, and I programmatically overrode the display handler so to get rid of pagination, right? So here's the view without pagination. Only to discover that that means that it cached the view when you hit the endpoint. So the view as it's displaying on .com now tried to serve the cached version with all of the nodes in the list instead of the 600 pages that there should have been of it. So we made the rule, and then, of course, because it's fun, we break it. So we're making a custom module that delivers JSON packet, right? Just use Drupal JSON. Puts it together and delivers it as JSON. And then the rule is that to write minimal code. So if there's logic or munging that needs to happen, it happens in the mid-tier, right? Because we don't want to build too much into the Drupal 6 site, right? We want the mid-tier to be flexible, and the mid-tier is much easier right now to be able to iterate on. Get rid of and add pieces add a microservice or take a microservice away. So we also made the rule of use the abstraction layer. So use the APIs and functions. Load the node, return the node object, right? Use the database abstraction functions, because a lot of this stuff, we could just hit the database, write a SQL MySQL query, hit the database and return it, right? But we're trying to do it in a way where we get all of the benefits of Drupal as a framework while we're doing it. We also decided to, to deliver the content in a Drupal-y way. So we have endpoints that deliver the menus. You say the name of your menu, you get back a list of the links. You say, give us the node ID, we give you back all the associated data with the node. Give us the name of a view and the parameter it expects, you get back everything that the view gives you as JSON. And this was a decision, we wrestled with this a little bit, right? Because we want it to be kind of content agnostic, but it isn't. It's all architected in Drupal, so we give it away, we deliver it in the way that Drupal organizes content architecture. We start simple, so we only add complexity if there's a strong business case to do it. Because we're the being the back end of this, we can give you everything. Like, we don't have to really do too much about edge cases, right? So this helps. So a solution to the views caching problem is to go back and edit all of the views, and I don't know how many there are, but there's a lot, and make the default view without pagination, and then make the other views with pagination so that when we dip it, then I'll break .com. We'll break .com. I'll break it and .com fix it. Caching, right, is always the challenge. Like, the delivering the views then is cached in other ways that other things aren't also cached, and so we had to be really super clever about how to do that, or I think it's super clever. And then the other thing that's, you know, unusual is, so part of the custom module is a RAML file, and the RAML file identifies the JSON output for each of the endpoints. And that was something that, and programming in Go is something that we're just ramping up on. I've not written in Go before, but they had adapted it again for one little bit of slice. For Apple News, the internal team had adapted using Go, and there's a couple of developers now ramped up on it. Then we did some training, and eventually the mid-tier will move into the team, and we won't freak out.
Yeah, and RAML essentially acts as a definition for the API endpoints that we can then build in to automatically mock up those objects. So think of it in terms of a contract between the different tiers of the application. So between the mid-tier and the back-end, we can have a RAML file that defines what both parties expect, and then we both can build towards that.
So we have things that we'll skip, like why we chose Go, which is interesting if that's a particular question. So we're at the same time all of this is happening. Right now there's a pretty Drupal standard deployment strategy. So everybody merges to the develop branch, and then that goes to stage once a week, and then it's tested, and then it goes to production. But this is about continued industry integration. What I'm thinking, though, is we probably want to, because this gets into a piece that's tangentially related, then there's a whole other product that moves all of the subscriptions, user authentication, entitlement, login away.
It's scary stuff.
It's scary stuff. So, but that's tangential, and so we can talk about this, but we have 10 minutes, so I thought we've covered a lot already. We'll take a pause, take some questions. If we use up all the time with questions, that's totally fine, because I think this is probably enough to focus on. Mm-hmm. Eric.
Hey, I was curious if you guys could go over the Go slides.
The Go slides? Yeah. Yay! You were hoping someone would ask. Did you ask him before?
No, I did not.
No. So we're actually doing something extremely similar, except in our mid-tier, we actually are doing it in Java, so I'm just more interested in
one. And there's which we don't have with us, but that was a slide about Java pipe. Comparing the options.
Then I would love that slide.
we may be able to arrange that, but effectively we evaluated Go, we looked at using Python, we looked at Ruby, we looked at Node itself, because we're already using Node on the front end. And the reasons that we chose Ho-Ling is performance. It is a very, very performant language. It supports concurrency out of the box. It's very easy in Go to write something that's going to go across multiple processes. That's pretty much it. It also doesn't have a dependency nightmare like Ruby would have. So, Go compiles into a binary that you drop on a server. So,
and now that we've been through 2 days advanced training, we could draw boxes and show you how the hexadecimal headers are now saved in memory and when they get cached and don't use buffered something.
Yeah.
But I still can't yet. Right. Anyone else?
When you talked about Drupal 8, you mentioned that moving to Drupal 8 is on the table. I'm curious what else is on the table.
So they say easy publish, which I don't, I've never used before. It's something, I think, I'm sorry, I want to let you answer this question. I think the answer in my head, and then you can correct me. The answer in my head is Drupal 8 and or, right? That they don't want to settle on a decision to say, yes, Drupal 8. There's some thinking about it. But I think...
Yeah, I think fundamentally the takeaway message is what Drupal 8 would be doing in the stack is a content authoring experience that could be done possibly by many other CMSs. The reason that Easy Publish comes in, as we can see here, it's going to be used as the marketing CMS for the subscription side of the business, so it will already be a technology that we're using, so it will be something that we likely evaluate. And it will come down to what's the right technology solution for the business need that we have, which is in itself a little bit of a departure from where we've been. Like, we build everything in Drupal because that's what we have. That isn't necessarily the smartest decision. If I was building APIs, I wouldn't necessarily build them in Drupal. You know, the Drupal bootstrap would make that probably not a wise idea.
But 8 more so. So I think you know, basically it's on us, and we're happy to take this challenge over the next 6 months or so to be able to strategically and solution architecturally make a case for why it's the right tool, right? And I'm happy to make that case.
Okay, I have a question at the end.
Okay. You. So I don't have to pick because it's very trend. It's very. I find it very tense to pick. So you can pick. Okay.
All right. Two performance related questions. How much time does it take to publish content to the front end from Drupal?
That is a very good question.
We don't know. We don't have any tests written yet.
And how long does it take to load page on cold cache?
From the new front-end stack?
Yeah.
Same answer. Still work in progress, I'm afraid. But we will definitely get back to you with how whiz-bang we've made it.
But the world if the world if is an example...
But approximate, like 30 seconds, 20 seconds.
No, there's a Robin has a parameter for this, and we should have written it down. And I'm sorry that I don't know what it is, but there's a metric. And the metric is one of the top three things that have to happen on this project, and it's stupid fast.
Yeah, so because we have such a large site with some front-end performance issues at the moment, a performance budget is part of the spec of this project. Now, that isn't cold cache. So what a request would be like with cold caches all the way through, I don't even know that we'd be able to synchronize clearing caches on all the different parts of the stack to be able to make that happen.
Well, it's designed not to have a cold. It shouldn't, because of the layers of caching that make debugging, make debugging a joy, there should never be hit the MySQL database, display it on the front end. That should never happen. That something is seriously wrong if that happens. So I think it's something we would measure, but that's a calamity, I think. I think I'm not overstating it, maybe a little.
Thank you.
The question is, though, how long when you make a change on the Drupal 6 site does it show up on the front end? Because this is what editorial will want to know. I don't know. I don't know.
Vonix purging magic happening off the back of node edits and that kind of stuff going on. So,
yeah.
Watch this.
We have one more over here.
Okay. Do I go
from
first?
The middle of the room?
Okay. Okay. Cool. So obviously this is like a very high volume traffic website. So could you give some sense of how you've decided to scale this really nice and sophisticated architecture? You have load balancers in front of every tier, like in front of the mid tier, because it seems to be doing a lot, and also in front of the Drupal backend tier. Like just some sense of like how you can scale this to like a million visitors per day.
So, the existing Drupal 6 site is in AWS, so there's this pretty standard AWS stack with Route 53 at the top and elastic load balancers. The actual Drupal instances are EC2 instances that auto-scale. There's RDS in the back end as the actual database layer. In terms of the actual, what we expose from Drupal all gets cached in Varnish, so obviously that's going to be pretty snappy. In terms of the mid-tier, also going to be in AWS using their Docker service, and also with auto-scaling. So, yeah. Lots of leveraging AWS, lots of auto-scaling ways of making sure that all these individual Docker components register themselves with a service provider that says, if you're requesting blog content, I have any one of these three microservices that are running that you can go ping. And you know, lots of information baked in to those Docker components that expose information about how to help check them, so what URLs to ping, how often to ping them, and a service that monitors that and allocates new ones if they're failing.
So my other question was about the RAML file. Right now we're trying to figure out how to get this working correctly. Like, so when we do a rollout, right, there's actually a version mismatch. How are you guys working through that? Like, is the middle tier like checking the RAML file all the time for every request coming through, or?
It will be. Right now, I haven't even written any tests. We've been like delightfully able to just build things, but there's Selenium for end-to-end testing, and then there's contract testing between the tiers. Fortunately, we don't have to do it in Drupal. We just have to make sure we don't break .com, but the mid-tier uses the RAML file to do, or uses the RAML files, and the front-end and mid-tier between each other use the RAML files for their contract tests.
Each individual microservice would run as a Docker component, and within that actual component, there would be the RAML file that defines what that So version 1.2 would be a completely different component.
Yeah.
So context for my question is I'm generally concerned about the loss of function that we might be building into the web as engineers doing these cool things with React and so forth, because HTML will load on all kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you gave any thought to that, particularly since you said you were targeting China. My understanding is a large number of internet users in China are only accessing the phone on, or on the web on feature phones that don't have JavaScript.
Well, the easy answer to that is no, because we're not architecting the front end, so this is not our thing we have to figure out. And that, I think, Angelo's team, and you certainly...
My understanding is that it degrades gracefully, so it just doesn't give you that... if you look at anything like React that does an initial page load and then is doing all kinds of magic behind the scenes, so when you navigate, it looks like there isn't even a page load happening. That just wouldn't happen on a feature phone. So it doesn't prevent you from seeing the website or seeing the content. You just don't get the...
Delivering up a basic issue
at all.
Right.
Yeah. One of my complaints when I... worked on this project for almost 2 years, a while ago. And one of my complaints was how many browser versions back they made me cross-browser test for any feature that the team pushed out. So they're very, very interested in the metrics of the users. So if the metrics of the users say they're not able to consume the content because they're doing too fancy on the front end, that will have a tremendous, that they will hear that. That will be important.
That's why the team had to support IE7 for a particularly long time. Thank you, all you Windows XP users.
One right here. I'm curious if this is something that you completely dreamed up internally. There's a lot of other companies that are decoupling Drupal. There's headless Drupal on groups.drupal.org to talk about things. So did you talk to other companies, like some of the other NBC companies that have already decoupled Drupal, and talk to them about their experiences? Or did, you know, because you have such specific business needs, is this just completely an internal project?
All of those things. So, it was very important to make these decisions, right, based on the business case, right? And so identifying exactly what those parameters are and evaluating products based on that was a big part of it. From what I understand, there was a lot of discussion about possible migration options and interacting with other people in the community. So, for example, we've one of my personal favorite projects here in New York is the Sloan Kettering project, and they did a decoupled, like bringing in, making, changing, programmatically changing the front end into another front end. So this is has been and would continue to be something that's driven by the use case, but informed by the community. The Economist has always been, that has always been the case, and I'm sure that it would continue to.
Yeah, we've had a number of interesting conversations with the Four Kitchens guys. We've spoken to Phase 2. Lullabog reached out as well to talk to us about what we're doing. And, you know, although it's perhaps slightly different in some ways, in that maybe the role of Drupal is more tightly focused on content authoring, and I suspect Go might not be everyone's choice, but... So that part is certainly internal, and, you know, the actual mid-tier design is internal, but the synergy between what we're doing and what we discuss with other people around what they're doing in decoupled is pretty strong. So, you know, the basic approach is of making sure you have contract-based testing between the tiers. Here are some things to look out for. Hey, you might want to think about preview because your content editor is going to say, well, how do I look at this on a phone when I'm on this D6 back end? Yeah, we should really figure that out.
Not today.
We punted, basically.
At some point.
Yeah, we said, yeah, we know you're going to need that.
Third down.
We're
not going to go for it?
We'll get to that.
Yay, we did a football, yay! We did a football analogy.
And any stronger than that.
No, that's perfect. So how are we doing for time? Do we have time for more, or are we out?
Yeah, we have time for one or two more questions, if anyone has.
Is anyone, someone, did I see?
Ben? Yeah, one from Ben.
Thank you. I was curious if you could elaborate a little bit more on the middle tier layer. What's the translation that's happening, and why things like blog and image, and so maybe elaborate also on the contract between the middle layer and the front.
Yeah. So what we don't want to do is take content as it comes out from Drupal and expose that. So by the time the front end's consuming it, we don't want an excuse that D6 terminology might still be D6. I don't know, field underscore this underscore that, whatever. We just want a canonical model of what content represents. So when I'm requesting a blog, I'm expecting a headline, I'm expecting, like we said before, a created date, those kind of things, not very Drupal-specific terminology.
Oh.
And that really helps us when we incorporate other content types. So other content types, other repositories, potentially not even Drupal at all exposing data and trying to bring them together into a format that's not specific to any one and that's usable by any front end. So the ones that we know about now, the ones that we haven't even thought about, the ones that are coming 2 years down the line.
This is why you're one of my favorite people in the Drupal world, by the way. Thank you. And thank you for having us here. And I like that I live close to you now. Okay, all that gushing aside. So our slides, so the slide added some confusion. We don't actually deliver a blog. We just deliver Node because we don't care. We don't care what it is. The reason the mid-tier has a blog contract is that's what we're building first. So we're building the blog landing page, which is a view of associated nodes, and then a blog page itself. So that's why we're calling it that. Now, that service might still provide blog content exclusively because that's content that's available for free. You don't hit the pay barrier when you do it. So there might be a use case to have an endpoint in the mid-tier that just delivers blogs, or maybe it will expand and it will deliver, you know, a blog or an article. The thing is that usually
could be both. Could be a generic microservice that gives any content without much specific data in terms of fields, just sort of headline and some content. That could be a microservice that could go across all our content. There could be something really specific to present blogs. The idea is by encapsulating all that business logic in one microservice that does one thing and one thing well, then if you need to fork and do something else later on, you can pull that logic, it's nicely encapsulated, you can just put it aside. It's not interspersed within your code base and you have to go dig it out somewhere and no one knows what this field is anymore, but let's leave it because you know, we don't want to clean it up.
So it's defined by, you know, usual and customary, like what the fields would return. Blogs might be unique enough to be their own. And images, because, of course, that was, besides caching, going to be the big thing. Like, what do we do about the unique IDs that are translated in the body? What do we do about filter presets so that they have the variation for responsive images? We haven't even answered that question yet. So that's why the slide says those two things, but that's not necessarily the long-term architecture.
Mm-hmm. And yep, we got another one.
So if I'm not wrong, you said the backend tier it serves the whole node object. So like based on whatever node you're requesting, it could have maybe like 20 or 30 different fields, which would mean like you have to do 20 or 30 different joins to And the middle tier is really filtering it out. So how do you sort of, and after filtering, you probably need only three fields. So how do you justify that extra penalty you're taking to, you know, create the whole node object, but only in the end to only use, you know, your number of the information that you're getting?
So what we're doing is less directly querying the database, doing the joins, figuring out what needs to be there, and more, this is what Drupal understands a node object is. For this ID, here you go. And then the mid-tier can say, I'm interested in these fields, but not these other ones. In terms of, if you think about it in terms of a node load, if that content's being hit on the site, the cache is already warped for that. So in terms of exposing it, obviously we expose it, we turn it into JSON, and then that gets cached as a just another URL endpoint in Varnish. So yes, the first request is going to do the node load, but beyond that, you're just going to be getting a Varnish response that says, here's the fields.
And in order to parse down the data, we still have to get it, right? So we can, I think, I don't know performance-wise, but getting, we only want five fields, right? So we're going to query directly for those five fields to build a custom output versus node load and send it. I would imagine not hugely different, but I don't know. And performance for the endpoints is not, because of caching, is not so much, that's not so much an issue. That's where caching is good.
If you use the Drupal functions, if you use the Drupal APIs, you have a fairly decent chance that there's some good caching mechanism in there. If you're querying the database, then you need to do some custom caching on top of that, right?
Plus the Varnish cache, nobody knows, apparently everyone who knows when the Varnish cache expires has died or something, because we still don't know, but the rumor is about a year. So if you do a request for a node that if the mid-tier does a request for a node that's cached and there's been no editorial changes, which would then refresh the cache, then it served that same content for apparently, I guess, until Pavel dies, like, and somebody has to figure out. Well, we know that.
So I actually have a quick question.
Yeah.
How are you guys handling the challenges around relationships between nodes? Right.
I'm sorry, I got stuck. And how are you handling the challenges of relationships? And I thought that this was going in a different direction.
It's like the newlywed game on a cruise ship, right? Which one of you is more angry?
After a little while, people were like, okay, I just have to ask you. Yeah. How can you work with your wife? How come nobody asks me how I can work with my husband? Everybody asks Tom how he can work with his wife. Really? So, like, well, it's because we worked together for a long time.
But relationships between nodes. So, you know, publish. You got to publish out and make sure that that you know you have the correct, the correct state for related nodes. This one's not published yet, but this one is. Like, how are you handling those challenges?
So there's two answers. The first one, not quite there yet. The second one, the mid-tier is going to do a lot of collecting and packaging of different node objects. So for example, a blog site for us is a type of a categorization of blogs. So for example, we may request a blog site, for example, Democracy in America, and then that would return a list of NIDs that relate to the blog posts within that site. So at that point, the mid-tier is probably going to do subsequent requests for each of those individual nodes, package it up, hopefully cache it, and then send it onto the front end. So the mid-tier is going to be doing a lot of that. You know, we don't want...
So you don't have a node relationship field in any of your content types? Where a node is specifically related to another node.
You mean a node reference field?
A node reference field.
Yeah. So here's the here's the thing. Shut up. And here's why. Because I think it's going to involve recursion. And I don't want to have this conversation right now. Right now we've been able to use the view, the views has given us the association. So we say they want an association. We say here's the view, and it gives all the node IDs, and then they use the node endpoint to get the data for each one of those nodes. That works right now. But if we have to do what you're asking to do, I think so.
We'll get sad.
Yeah, okay. A little. Maybe.
Probably won't.
Yeah. All right, Mani has a question. I think this is going to be the last one, though, I think.
Why is every microservice written have to be written in Go? Can the teams have their own choice of language? And second, have you considered Amazon Lambda, since you're on AWS, to write your microservices?
Both good questions. Tempted to say Hubot told us to do it. Theoretically, we could have diverse microservices. So there's no reason why you couldn't have one microservice written in Go, another one written in Python, something else written in Java. Probably wouldn't want to do that unless you have some real solid reasons for it. And again, it comes back to we want to build an architecture that supports choosing the right technologies for the job in hand. So we're standardizing on Go. If there's reasons to diverge from that, we may do so.
Plus you get the expertise benefit. Like now when stuff breaks, the team knows, they know Drupal 6 and this custom code base really well, right? Diversify the micro, you know, the mid-tier services, then you have an edge case problem, you know, an edge case issue that cross-functional teams don't know how to do. Also, we have a team in London and a team in New York. So the question for us is anything they build, if it breaks at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, right, is ours. So it's important that the teams, they standardize enough to be able to be flexible, but not so much that it tells you exactly how you have to build everything.
In terms of Lambda, I'm not sure is the answer that I can give you. I know that we're leveraging the Amazon Container Service. I don't know if that could use Lambda or if it's completely different. Interesting question. We'd have to get back to you.
We don't know.
Which means
we don't know.
Didn't design it.
A perfect note to end on.
We
all
don't
right.
know. Can we go back to football?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I said, so who wants to volunteer to work on an enterprise Drupal 6 site? Now when I ask the question, who would be interested in working on that? Who'd be interested? Can you see why our resourcing is probably going to be a bit easier? And honestly, we're looking for one special person that is going to grow with this project so that a year from now when things break, they know how that happened and why and how to fix it. And so.
All right.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you very much. A couple real quick things before we wrap up. First of all, just real quick. Can you raise your hand if in the last 2 weeks you contributed either an entire module or to a module on Drupal.org?
2 weeks.
All right, in the last 2 to 3 weeks, let's just say. All right, so all of you with your hands raised should go talk to Ben Jeavons about doing a lightning talk on that module at some point in the near future. See what I did there? Okay, but please do remember, go talk to Ben. about doing some talks and doing something interesting. Next meetup is in this room on Tuesday, November 3rd. Make sure that you go to meetup.com and you confirm that you are coming, that you RSVP, and then Elijah is going to...
And just make it's Tuesday. It's the only time we're going to have a meetup on Tuesday. Make sure you note that. Our normal schedule, the first Wednesday of every month, will be back on schedule of January 2016.
Yes. We had, so this room is not always as easy to get, but now we've reserved it, like, for the next 2 years kind of thing. So we should be okay. But it is a Tuesday. It's the first Tuesday of the month. Excuse me? No, it's going to be the first, the normal schedule is the first Wednesday of the month. There is an exception this current meetup and the November meetup.
So we will,
I know, there's an exception, this meetup, November and December, we will fix that starting in 2016. Finally, don't forget, Bill's Bar downstairs, enter on 51st Street. And we're at the bar downstairs in Bill's Bar. I think they took it away. I was going to say, grab one last slice of pizza before you go.
We have pizza.
Say hi to your friends and neighbors here at your meetup. Introduce yourself to someone who doesn't know you. Thank you for coming. Yay! All right, go talk to NYC Town.